Look, good evening. Thank you. I'm really honored to be here. I have a lot of friends and family down in the back. If my kids get rowdy, my wife will just take them out. But you know, I'm really grateful that you guys took time out of your busy schedules to be here. It means a lot. I know everybody up here on this podium. It means a lot to us because it shows that you care. You know, I've been a Republican my whole life. I voted Republican my entire life. My family has voted Republican. I may have even voted for people sitting next to me. I won't say anybody's names. But you know, there comes a time that you kind of have to reassess what you're doing and look back and say, what we're doing isn't working. You know, there's that saying that says, if you repeat the same things over and over, expecting different results, that's insanity. Now, I don't want to say anything anybody's hearing say, but let's look at it this way. We vote the same way over and over every year or every election cycle. And when those representatives or those senators don't represent us, we wonder why. You know, we can't really figure out, you know, maybe they don't represent us. Maybe they don't understand. You know, we call, we talk, we send emails, and we don't really get the response that we're looking for. You know, the Libertarian Party has a good motto, maximum freedom, minimum government. When was the last time you felt we had minimum government? I dare say it's been a long time. You know, we spend more money to fix fewer roads. We have higher medical expenses and go to the doctors less. For the last 16 years, taxes have increased while income has remained flat when adjusted for inflation. Companies are told what to do, who to sell to, and why. This is not what the government, our founders had intended. This is not minimum government. You know, Thomas Jefferson once stated that the purpose of the Constitution is to serve as chains, to bind the mischief of government. Well, I'm here to say it's time we put those chains back on. We can bring back our government. We can allow ourselves to be represented by we the people of the people. We've got a lot of work to do. We'll talk about a lot of bills tonight. My time's up, so I'll wrap it up. But, you know, I hope that you guys allow us all the opportunity to speak. I know you're here to hear us. Hopefully, at the end of the day, we can show that there are options out there. Thank you very much.
Good evening. Thank you for the League of Women Voters for having this event. If they weren't hosting it, y'all wouldn't even have this opportunity. Thank you all for coming out here. Thank you for all the support from the Libertarian Party and our friends and family. And most importantly, thank you for Tiffany Ray, now Tiffany McCurry. Today is our 1-year anniversary, and she let me come out here and do this thing. So thank you, Tiffany. Now, I do want to echo what Joey said. He said it very well. We have wasted a lot of time, a lot of money. As the gentleman down at the table said, we have a lot of one-time money from the DOT. I think it's kind of good that we're getting that money, but wouldn't it be better if we kept the money in the first place? Why are we sneaking down there asking for the money we're paying in the first place? I think it would be a lot better if that money was controlled locally and spent more responsibly locally. And really, truly, that goes for everything. And it goes down to the principle of the issue. I mean, they mean well. I'm not saying for a second they mean bad. They're not bad people. They're good folks. But they're going about it the wrong way. And that's what the Libertarian Party sees, and that's what we want to change. We want to bring a new approach to it. You know, if that means auditing the DOT, no one's accepted, has an exception for being audited. No one should. And, you know, to save your time, I think I'm done.
Now we will begin the question and answer portion of the evening. If you would, if you do not have a card, if you would raise your hand, and through medical care, social services for vulnerable children and adults, law enforcement, and much more, what do you think are the most important guiding principles in deciding how and how much to fund these needs?
That is one heck of a mouthful of question for a relatively simple answer. the guiding principle is what did the Constitution give permission to the government to do? It was very specific on what it was. It was very specific on what they were allowed to do. And really, that's my guiding principle. And it was that way for many years. And all of it was taken care of. The question becomes, how was it taken care of? It was a mixture of charity, goodwill. A lot of churches did a lot more work. We had a lot more charity hospitals. There was a lot of stuff. A lot of those things were being taken care of. And when government walks in there, says we will take care of it, it crowds it out. And it looks like today that it's impossible to be done privately. When I want to say that's completely wrong. It can be done privately, it can be done charitably, it can be done with our neighbors helping out our neighbors. We are taxed at some of the highest rates of any country in the world. Not the highest, but we are one of the highest. And despite this, we are still the most charitable nation this world has ever seen. So let us think in for a second. Despite the fact that we're having more money taken away from us than most other countries, we're still giving whatever we have left anyways. Think of how much more we could get, how much more would be out there, how much we're capable of if we turn to our neighbor instead of to the government. I mean, that's the guiding spot, that's the guiding principle. Is it better to ask someone to go to the government, to have resources taken from someone else to be given to you, or is it more moral, more right to say, go to your neighbor, just come to me, I have the extra cash. And that's my guiding star.
So I think everybody still remembers the question, but basically it's how do we fund, what's our guiding principles to decide how much the fund needs. Look, there's a lot of opportunities for improvement in all of these areas. And I think one of the primary concerns with me is that there's a lack of auditing and irresponsible spending throughout our government in Columbia. You know, for instance, and I don't want to spend all my time, I'm going to, but I don't want to spend all my time on the DOT, but it's already come up, so I'm going to talk about it. You know, we spend about $440 million a year on roads through SCDOT. I think we probably all agree in this room that the roads are in some of the worst conditions that we've seen, at least in my lifetime. I may not be as old, but I've still seen some pretty bad roads. And I've traveled all over the place. Our leaders in Columbia tried to pass the gas tax bill. Thankfully, we had a very liberty-focused senator in Columbia, Senator Davis, that basically filibustered and was able to block that bill. So, they could stop there. Our leaders in Columbia thought that, hey, you know what, now they're looking at basically selling bonds at $2.2 billion in debt. So not only can we not use a $1.2 billion surplus that they've already overtaxed us, it's a $1.2 billion surplus, so they've overtaxed us. Rather than use that, and you know, we'll use that on pet projects or whatever else we want to spend it on, and we can't audit the $440 million that they get annually, we just want to go in debt $2.2 billion more. That makes no sense. There's not a person in this room that could do that to a local bank to go there and say, hey, I'm already in debt, but let me pull out a bunch more money, you know, almost 5x what we've been asked for. We're going to have to start looking at how we audit ourselves. Someone mentioned the ethics bill already. Part of that ethics bill basically allows for some more internal audits. We're going to have exterior audits. We've got an attorney general for the state that is basically blocking audit against the SCDOT. That's unacceptable. It's not fair to the taxpayers. It's not fair to anybody in this room or anybody in the state of South Carolina. We can't spend more and more money to fix the problem. Sure, $2.2 billion goes a long way to fix the roads, but it's not going to fix them long term. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And let me clear up one thing about the DOT audit. The DOT audit has been done. It's on the website. It's been out for about 2 weeks. It has been finished, and it was a very comprehensive DOT audit. It is sitting on the website if you want to take a look at it. It has been finished. We're talking about the budget. I got a chart here of how we spend our money in the state of South Carolina. I just want to show you how we spend the budgeted money in South Carolina. K-12 education, 38%. So every dime that comes into education, 38% of every dollar that comes into South Carolina goes to K through 12 education.
Could you tell us which color that is?
That is the
Light blue, right here.
Okay.
I'm sorry. It's the biggest piece of the pie. And then you have higher ed right here at 9%.
That's your colleges and universities. That's the gray area. That's 9%. So if you add those two together, that's about 47% of the state budget goes to education. And it's growing every year. Now, you hear a lot about local government funds and all those kind of things. I know Carl is very concerned about local government funds, but he's going to be sitting on the county council before long. You know, we certainly need to fund those things. We don't fund them at what they should be funded. I agree with that 100%. But you also got to understand that when you start taking money from one of these other areas, your local school district gets hurt when you start pulling money out of the biggest pot of the pie, don't it? And then they're going to start hollering, well, you don't fund us. There's only so much money there. 26% health and social. That's the mental health thing. That's growing at an astonishing rate in this state. Mental health issue. You got governmental, 6%. You got criminal justice, 9%. The others, 12%. That's the pie chart for the state's budget right there. You see that most of it goes to education. So we have to make sure that when we talk about the $1.2 billion in surplus money, well, all that's not recurring money. So you can't put non-recurring money on state highways. Because how are you going to pay for it next year when it's just one-time money? You can go out and fix a few potholes with it, but you can't put non-recurring money in recurring items, but such as highways and bridges.
To answer the question in one sentence, I guess what I look at is first, is it of course function of government, and then two, is it the most conservative way that we can address the issue? And to give some real life examples, last year we had a decision on whether to do a bond bill, and it was primarily for higher education, and voted against that because from at least what we were provided there, and these things you also have to realize are provided to you in a quick time frame. So within a few days, we go from not knowing anything about a bond bill to having to vote for it. So from the knowledge that I had at the time, it was, is this the best way to go forward? And with a surplus at the time, I did not feel that was the best way to go forward doing a bond. Other examples are, again, with the roads. We did have a roads bill through the House last year, and I voted against it for a number of reasons. One was the gas tax or the surplus, but two was mainly my biggest issue was the reform that we had was not good enough reform for me to justify it. So each issue is case by case, but the short answer is a core function of government, and is there a better way to do it? Sort of piggybacking on what's been talked about, there's a lot of misinformation out there, and that's the toughest thing. The toughest thing is being an elected official is communicating with it's of our constituents, and you know we're down there in Columbia, and from 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. we're confronted with all of this information, and trying to relay that to $1.2 billion excess sounds like a lot, but then when you get down into it, we are woefully behind in EFA funding, that's education funding. We're woefully behind in LGF, that's local government funding. By the time we increase just a little bit on both of those, by the time we do our other mandated funding, we're left in this year with $1.2 billion. It was something around $300 or $400 million that we could actually play around with. So I just encourage you to also do the research on what we actually have to deal with. It's a little bit more complicated than one-liners, but that's part of the beauty of it.
I believe the most important things that government does, number one, is to provide for public safety. Number two, provide a strong educational system that's going to prepare our students to become productive citizens. And when we look at the amount of funding that we give to education, I think that's a very good investment in what we do. Now, granted, South Carolina does not have the best reputation in the educational community around the nation, but I think when you look at South Carolina, we are held back by a small area of our state that has been grossly underfunded for a long time. And the reason for that is because they don't have economic development. And so we're having to take some steps to try to increase funding in those areas to give those students opportunities that they wouldn't necessarily have but for the fact that the legislature is doing that and now that it is being court mandated. I believe that when we talk about this bond bill for our transportation system, that's $2.2 billion that the Senate has proposed. Now, we haven't considered that yet. But this same senator that held up the gas tax last year voted for this $2.2 billion bond bill. Just about every senator voted for it because they were afraid to face the long-range responsibilities that we have. We've got to have a consistent source of funding for the future so that we can really attack our roads and bridges. This $2.2 billion goes for projects such as Malfunction Junction, where all the major roads around Columbia come into play, I-385 over here in Greenville, repaving a primary road system here in South Carolina, and trying to fix 400 bridges over the next 10 years here in South Carolina. We have a lot of things that we have to address, but public safety, education, health care, including mental health and Medicaid, are huge responsibilities that we have, and I'm proud of what we're doing in that area.
Thank you, gentlemen. As you are preparing your questions, may I ask if you would put one question per card, so if you have a bunch of questions, then collect a bunch of cards. And the other thought is, please direct, create your question so that it is applicable to all the candidates. We do not wish to have any candidates, any questions that are directed to any one specific person. The next question, we will begin with Mr. Lum, and this one is related to home rule, everybody's favorite home rule. South Carolina adopted a form of home rule for counties and cities in the 1970s, but the question continues to arise, how are responsibilities and authority best allocated between state and local government? Do you believe that state government currently intrudes too much on home rule or allows local governments too much autonomy, or gets it about right? Please include some examples.
All right, I'll try to keep my one-liners to a minimum. So first off, and I kind of want to just go back a little bit, but it does deal with this home rule. I think, and at least in my opinion, I think education should be made more private. I know that is a very important part. I have three young children in the back. My first will be attending Lakeview. But I think, you know, when they always crunch the numbers and the state does this, it says this is how much it costs per student to send them to school. And I think it came out to $11,000 to $13,000 per student. I can assure you that I'm spending way less to send my son to school next year. I would happily take that money. I will take half of it. I would take a third of it as a voucher. So if I had the opportunity to vote for a voucher, I guess I'm saying I would. One more thing. Yeah, so, and it kind of ties into this home rule, we'll get into that, but, you know, this started out in 1895, and then home rule kind of got readdressed in 1975. And one of the primary components of home rule that I'd like to see is that in many states, it allows for voter initiatives that voters want to have brought up on a ballot. They can start a petition, and then it becomes a referendum to be voted on. South Carolina currently does not allow that. So in this state, if we want to have an issue, if we want something to be brought up, for a vote, it basically goes through Columbia. Everything's funneled through Columbia. There's a lot of other states, I think it's 38 or 39 states currently, have the ability to bring up a petition or become a referendum and be voted on. So it's an up or down vote. So I think a lot of people throughout the state would say, hey, we agree, let's have an up or down vote. You know, let's let our voice be heard. Another part that we can kind of look at for this home rule, and this has come up with the school districts, is how autonomous they can be
from legislative delegations. How do they get their money? Are they fiscally responsible? Are they structurally responsible? Different counties throughout the state are, it's all different. Different counties have different roles, and some get this amount of money. I think what we need to do is allow local areas to control what schools get the money and what they do with it. I think free market economy takes care of itself. If Pickens County does exceptionally well in schools, then more and more people will want to come to Pickens County, creating more taxes, which in turn goes right back into the school. But it's not true if everything gets routed through, you know, the state government instead of the local government. Thank you.
Home rule only works if your local government is successful in making it work. And fortunately, Pickens County is successful in making it work. There's other counties in this state that their home rule does not work because they don't have the capabilities, they don't have the people in place, they don't have the elected officials that can do the job, that can manage the authority that they're given to them. Let me give you an example of what just recently happened. We all know about the 1,000-year flood that we experienced last October. Well, the first thing that happened when we got back in the session, some counties were standing at the door waiting on us when we got back in the session, saying, who's going to fix my roads? Who's going to fix my bridges? And you know what? They're the same ones that want to scream, don't mess with us. Keep your hands off of us. But when something like that happens, they come running to the state and say, can you fix our roads for us? Can you fix our bridges for us? Either you're going to have home rule or you're not going to have home rule. And so that's one of the big issues is that a lot of counties, and I'm all for home rule. I think the best decisions are made at home. I'm all for home rule. I think the best decisions are made at a local school board and made at a local county level because they're the same people that elected me that elect them. So I don't think they're dumb in electing them and smart in electing me. I think they're smart when they elect the people that they elect. But home rule will only work if the people that you've elected at home can be in charge of what you ask them to do. But you can't have part-time home rule, and when you need the state, you come running to the state and say, you know, I need millions of dollars to redo the things that we can't have. Either you're going to have home rule or you're not going to have. So I think that's one of the biggest issues in the state of South Carolina is it's home rule by convenience for some folks. So I think it's very important. I think Pickens County does a great job with home rule. I think we have very knowledgeable people running this county. But I also think that there's a lot of counties in this state that don't. You got to understand that there's 124 of us in the state house, and they're all representing their county just like we're representing ours.
I agree with Chairman Hyatt, I'm supportive of home rule, and I believe that the government closest to the people is probably the best form of government, and we see that, and you can see that as an example here recently. Unfortunately, in our county, we just closed two elementary schools, and we actually didn't hear anything from the state delegation on that, and that's because, in our viewpoint, that was a policy decision based for our school. Same with county council issues, and I can tell you just about once a week we are confronted with something to do with in the purview of the county council that we don't make any statements on or anything like that. Now, the difference with our seventh school board seat is that it comes down to governance, and when our school board is failing as far as not being able to move one way or the other, and its governance is a function of what we do, then we did decide to get involved in that. So I also agree that, you know, we also have to take that responsibility, as Chairman Hyatt is saying. We're confronted by both county council and school board as far as bringing more money back, actually more than what our pro rata share is, when if we were true home rule people, then we would say, no, we want that tax base to maintain at home. We want, whether it's a sales tax or millage tax on whatever the issue may be, whether it's a new detention center or whether it's a local government fund or whether it's maintenance for our schools. If we're true to ourselves about home rule, then we would tax ourselves. We wouldn't ask the government for more money, the state government that is, for more money. So I agree. I think the government closest to the people is best, but we also have to be responsible when we say that.
control's been in existence in South Carolina by and large since 1975, and I believe that it works. I think that the tools are there that for the counties that are properly governed and managed, they can be successful, and we only have to look around us to see the ones that are. I think that comes down to proper budgeting. You know, we always have complaints from local governments about our local government fund. At the end of the day, local government has the opportunity to adjust taxes. They can not have a tax increase, or they can have incremental tax increases within the state law. You know, when we talk about voter initiatives, in my opinion, voter initiatives and voter decisions are made every 2 and every 4 years. Every time you vote for people who hold public office, you in essence are having an initiative on the decisions that are going to be made. And the idea that everything is going to be brought to a vote is contrary to our representative form of government. The reason that we are sent to Columbia is to make decisions that you've empowered us to do. And when I ran 2 years ago, I ran with the idea that I was going to offer reasonable, sensible representation and leadership. And that's what I've tried to do. I believe that I reflect the people who sent me there, the opinion of the people who sent me there. You know, when we talk about education in South Carolina and how much comes back to the local government or to the school board, it's an increase this year to $2,350 in the base student cost. Now, that's not where it was prior to the recession, but we're incrementally getting back to that because of the other needs that we have. When you talk about $11,000 to $13,000 for the cost to educate a student, that varies from county to county. It can be as high as $19,000 or $20,000 in some counties, and as low as in the $9,000 to $10,000 in others. So it's not comparing apples to oranges, or apples to apples, it's apples to oranges when you get down to that.
Okay, I don't disagree with that. That's not comparing apples to apples and oranges to oranges. So let's do that. Public schools spend $11,000 to $13,000 per student per year. That's fact. Private schools charge about $8,000 to $9,000 per student per year. They charge that much more for not as good of a product. That's just bottom line. And as Joe mentioned earlier, he's taking his kids to a local private education facility. I believe it's a church, I'm not really sure what exactly what it is. I haven't visited myself. But he's being charged far less than that. Far less than $11,000 to $13,000. And that's across the state. $8,000 to $9,000 across the state. Now as far as home rule is concerned, I find it kind of immoral to suggest that counties who have their road money taken from them sent to the state for Columbia to decide what we're done with it, where we'll go, for Columbia to be mocked. When you say, these are the same people who want home rule, they want their money back. They already sent their money to Columbia. They want that money back. If they were allowed to keep it, then they could save it. Then they could use it effectively. And going back to the question, the home rule, as it was written, didn't go far enough. But the thing about it is, they're not even respecting it as it is. You have decisions as simple as what is the local group going to name the local bridge being done at the state. And that's a huge waste of our state time. For the folks that are being sent down there, for all you guys, that's a huge waste of your time to decide what a bridge is named. That's what can be done locally. And, you know, I respect all the time better than that. Thank you.
Mr. Hyatt, we'll ask you to field this next question first. The Citizens United decision did away with limits on donations to independent political action committees, but still asserted the citizens' interest in disclosure of donors to those PACs. Do you believe that South Carolina citizens have a right to know who provides financial support for political messaging intended to influence their votes?
Thank you for that. Every quarter, an elected official or a candidate is required to file an ethics report. And on that ethics report, if it's $100 or more, if you have received a contribution from someone, whether it's an in-kind gift or a financial gift, if it's $100 or more, you're required to put that on your ethics report. And that's online for any individual to see. All you have to do is go to ethics.sc.gov, I believe is what it is. And you can click on my name or anybody's name and see exactly who's giving us money, how much they've given us, their address. And so we're required by law to do that every quarter now. Now let's talk a little bit about dark money. We've heard that term from time to time, dark money. Dark money is the third party out there that's maybe campaigning for someone and they don't, and we've all experienced that. I know Representative Clary had that happen to him almost right before the election 2 years ago. Someone sent out a mail piece criticizing his opponent, and he didn't even know it was coming out. And he was getting questions about, well, why did you send out that negative mail piece? He knew nothing about it. And to this day, unless I'm mistaken, to this day, he still doesn't know who sent that out. And you're going to see a ton of that happen between now and June 14th in this state. Because that dark money out there is money that, it comes from New York, it comes from California, it comes from everywhere. And they don't have any I believe if you do business in South Carolina, you ought to report it in South Carolina. Because if someone comes out and puts out a mail piece against Representative Clary, myself, or anybody, an individual ought to be able to know who's spending that money, who's backing that candidate. There's a lot of folks that have a lot of money in this country that spend a lot of money trying to defeat or win political races. And you're going to see a lot of it between now and June the 14th. When you're going to hear the term dark money a lot between now and June 14th, because there's going to be a lot of folks that are spending a lot of money that you have no idea where it's coming from. I believe if it's been in South Carolina, it ought to be reported in South Carolina.
I completely agree. I think this is one of the failures of the Senate over this session. Dark money is not going to be addressed. In fact, as far as ethics are concerned, there are only two bills that they passed out. We passed out about 16, as well as an omnibus bill that combined all of the ethics bill into one. And unfortunately, the only two ethics bills that came out are source disclosure and then independent investigations. And that was, at least on the Senate side, a little bit of a misnomer, because half of it is half independent investigation. But as far as dark money is concerned, this is, in my opinion, as far as ethics, it is the number one issue. And we see it in our county every election cycle. Last cycle we saw with Judge Clary. This cycle, I guarantee you will see a number of campaign mailers and maybe even TV commercials against certain candidates. And when you do, that's a good time to see who is paid by. And then try to figure out who is funding those people. We all, the three of us, felt it during the roast debate. There's an organization called AFP that's doing mailers. They're also doing robocalls. Anytime you get a robocall, anytime you get any mailer, question where that money's coming from, and then try to find out who is actually paying. And these third-party groups, you won't be able to. And I think that does a disservice to the public. The public should know who's trying to influence them. And until we solve that problem, we're completely open. And their argument is that it is free speech, anonymous speech. And when it comes to the public should always have that transparency and know who's trying to influence them. So hopefully that will be one of the bills that we can attack next year.
I am a firm believer in ethics and transparency. And when you go to my state ethics filing, you will see that I list every contribution that I receive, regardless of the amount. It might be $20 in cash or whatever it is, and it has a name attached to it. I think it is important for everyone to realize where money comes from in a campaign, because to run an effective campaign, it takes money. There's no question about it. And I'm proud of the people and the groups that have supported me over the last 2 years and continue to support me now. But insofar as dark money is concerned, it's been documented here what happened to me 2 years ago. I campaigned on the idea that I was going to be positive and campaign on the issues. Unfortunately, the day before the election 2 years ago, a group out of Washington, D.C. Put out a mailer that was very disparaging to my opponent. I had a couple of Facebook posts that night that, you know, folks that were supporting my opponent said, you know, you said you were going to run a positive campaign, but you weren't going to do that. And so by the time I saw it the next morning, one of those folks emailed me and said, you know, I owe you an apology. That didn't come from you. But how many people did not know where that came from? And that's the whole problem with it. When you have the Kochs, the Edelmans, the Friedmans, and people like that funding groups that are pouring dark money into campaigns, and that money's coming from all over the place, we deserve to have the information where we know who makes contributions to these third-party groups. That's the only way we're going to have transparency, and that's the only way you're going to be able to make an intelligent choice. So I would say this, that be very discerning of calls that you get and mailers that you get unless you know where they came from.
Again, very simple answer. If you are spending money to influence political decisions that will affect other people in your community, it should be open, transparent, and recorded. Bottom line, I don't care if it's sent directly to me, if it's sent to a PAC. I do not think for a second there should be a limit on how much, because that is free speech. But it should be apparent. It should be clearly apparent. There should be no way of hiding that. And it should be punished if you are. And I do feel bad for Mr. Cleary for that Russian money that I sent down here to help him out by this time. It must have been very embarrassing. And I'm glad you got to the bottom of it, by the way. Thank you.
Yeah, so I think, you know, it's kind of an interesting question, especially if you go back and look at the McCain-Feinstein bill in the original sense when this first came up. But, you know, most of us up here, actually all of us up here, agree. I don't know about dark money. I'll take green money, really. I'll take any money. But, so anytime that someone tries to influence the elections, I mean, this is what that's about, right? So as an individual, anyone in this room can donate $1,000, right, maximum. If you have a PAC, right, or a super PAC, as you hear it in the news all the time, it's considered free speech. The Supreme Court held unanimously that it was, 9-0, that it was free speech. So if they, as a group or a union or as a corporation, you know, decide, and without us knowing about it, they can donate any amount of money, have advertisements, etc. The law already, or as it is stated now, it says the key issue by the Supreme Court was that everything is disclosed to prevent corruption or the appearance of corruption. So yeah, so I mean, you'll see that stuff, and especially on a national scale. I don't think Davey has anything to worry about from me. Like I said, I'll take any donation. But the important thing here is that, in general, we don't have outsiders trying to influence the election. And everybody said it up here, you know, all this stuff is on, you know, our ethics.gov page. And I encourage you to look it up. You know, you may be surprised at who donates to some of the candidates that you may vote for. Not just the representatives, but the Senate, as well as on a national scale. You may see corporations or companies that donate to some of these candidates from not only outside of, you know, the county, but maybe on the other side of the state or from states, you know, four or five states away, or construction companies or whatever. And when we start talking about ethics reform and road bills and all those other things, again, may not be relevant to all of these candidates right here, but it's definitely relevant. You should encourage yourselves to look at who's donating and then why, right? Obviously, there's a reason they're donating massive amounts of money. Thank you.
We will continue now with questions from the audience, and we'll ask Mr. Collins to field this first one. As a representative for the citizens of Pickens County, what efforts would you make to get more jobs and industry to look more closely at locating in Pickens County?
Well, hey, that's a, we can talk about for a little bit, but first thing is what I have already done. First, let's go over that. Number one is setting up relationships with the people that we need to set up relationships with. Last Thursday, I met with our Secretary of Commerce, Bobby Hitt, and it was on a separate piece. But those relationships that hopefully will lead, he's the one that oversees all the applications for new businesses, for businesses to expand. In fact, this was the morning that Pickens County announced their reliable expansion, which sort of leads into the second part. And the second part is on economic growth. A lot of it is driven by our county council. And with him, his exact quote to me was, the expansion of Reliable, which has been a stable here in Pickens County, was like pulling teeth to try to get that expansion. And that shouldn't be the way that we operate in Pickens County. So we have issues within our own county that we need to address. The third part going towards the state is we need to make this as business friendly as possible. And whether it's tax rates, whether it's fee and lieus, whether it's our education system, the first thing that any major corporation wants to see when they land in a county is the schools. So we also, it's a multifaceted approach, and for a minute and a half response, I'll try to do the best to.
I don't think there's any question that economic development is the lifeblood of our communities, which result in the lifeblood of our state. What is key to that is a strong educational system. We've been very blessed to have great schools in Pickens County. I'm concerned at this particular point in time when we look at our budgetary situation with our school district that we're going to be falling behind the curve. And that's one reason that we passed the seventh seat in the House last year, and it still sits in the Senate. But I think when we look at that educational system and the Career Technology Center that we have out on Chastain Road, it is world class. If you haven't been there, you need to go look at it, because it's putting out some very impressive young men and women. Another thing, it has to be a team approach. It has to involve state legislature, county council, school board in trying to attract these business and industries here. Another huge, huge step would be membership in the Upstate Alliance. When Representative Collins and I were sworn in 2 years ago, and we were invited to the governor's mansion for a luncheon with our other freshman colleagues, the governor and Secretary Hitt immediately approached us and said, the biggest thing you can do in Pickens County is have membership in the Upstate Alliance.
When you create rules, regulations, and controls that build walls to prevent businesses and make it difficult to start businesses and expand and create jobs, and then complain that we don't have any jobs. When, to be fair, that is a problem. We need to find jobs in Pickens County more than anything else. And there's many things we can do. One, get rid of a lot of those regulations. One, why do you need a license to cut hair? That exists. You have to have a license to cut hair. Why? There's a lot of rules and regulations. Like, for example, going back to the education issue, my wife has a bachelor's degree with a major in early childhood education. My mother-in-law has been a public school teacher for 40 plus years. They cannot, as the way the rules are right now, cannot teach 10 kids out of my home privately in between them, those parents voluntarily sending them there and us voluntarily teaching them because of those rules and regulations. But that's just one example. You get rid of a lot of that where you can enable that to happen, you'll have a lot of jobs brought up. Quality jobs that create quality education on top of that. Government needs to step aside and let us solve our problems. They've already gotten in the way and caused them. We have to stop them from causing it. Thank you.
Yeah, so, you know, this all boils down to kind of what we talked about all day, which is kind of nice, the tax rates, obviously. If we can lower tax rates or decrease the tax rates for businesses, one, that are already here and they want to expand, or two, that are prospectively coming here or would rather go to Anderson or some other county that has a lower rate. And thankfully, Pickens County, you know, has lowest rates compared to, you know, say, Greenville County. The other part, and it's already been mentioned, is schools. Like, so obviously, business look at schools because those schools are where people are going to live, and that's where they want to raise their children and also work at the plant or whatever it is that's local. We kind of talked about schools, but there's a charter school trying to start up in Easley. There's a lot of private schools, a lot of private Christian schools, which is, like I said earlier, where I'm sending my first one, and we'll be there next year. We can do better in our schools. Do we have good schools? Sure. Are they pretty good? Yeah. But we can do much better. We can have vouchering programs. We can eliminate some of these high costs of education and make better schools for Pickens County, which brings in better business. You know, on the last part, you know, when we start talking about manufacturing and the sourcing of these operations, I mean, thankfully, I've been doing that my whole life, you know, outside of the Marine Corps. We've been involved in manufacturing from day one. You know, when you start sourcing product, when you start trying to, you know, everything's local, that's what I do day to day, right? Is how close to the plant can I get stuff made? And that's what this is all about. We want to bring as much business as close as possible, And we do that by keeping tax rates low. We do that by creating good environments. We have homes being built. We create good infrastructure. And we have things ready for when companies want to come in. Thank you.
Up until Reliable Sprinkler made their announcement several weeks ago that they were going to expand in Pickens County, it had been since 2012 since Pickens County had any type of announcement at all about jobs coming to this state, I mean this county. 45 out of 46 counties in this state had made an announcement since Pickens County had. We were the only county that had not made an announcement since 2012. South Carolina only trails Texas in the number of jobs that have been created in the last 7 years. That ought to tell you something. Governor Haley's done a great job going out there with Bobby Hitt, Executive Director Hitt, going out and recruiting top-notch companies to come to this state. And we've got some great companies coming to this state, and I'm going to tell you something, there's some more sitting out there on the hook. We can just get them in. But Governor Haley's done a great job, but Pickens County has not seen one employee come to Pickens County until Reliable Sprinkler announced it there. And the main reason is, because we're not a member of the Upstate Alliance. When somebody has an interest in has an interest in South Carolina, and they go to the Department of Commerce, and Director Hitt says, well, they're interested in coming to the Upstate. Well, there's nine counties in that Upstate Alliance, and there's one missing. So they're not going to send that prospective client to the one that's not a member. They've got to be a member of Upstate Alliance. And I know I've heard things like it costs too much, you don't get a return on your investment. But we're not getting a return on our investment now. Well, maybe we are, but we're not getting anything. But we're not investing anything. So we've got to get back into Upstate Alliance and get it started. Therefore, we can play the game just like all the other 45 counties are doing, and we can get the job. You come to Pickens County, you don't usually leave, do you? People love it here. And people would love to come and set up business here. We've talked to prospective businesses, but they all say the same thing.
We're not going to be a part of that because your county is not a part of Upstate Alliance. They don't do the things we need them to do to encourage us to be that. So the county has got to become a part of Upstate Alliance in order for us to get back and play the ball.
Mr. Clary, may we start with you on this one? What improvements would you like to see happen in the next 2 years in Pickens County?
I'd like to say wow, but that's pretty easy. I think some of the things that we've talked about here, number one, having government relations that work together. You know, if all of our governments in Pickens County worked as well as our municipalities do, then we would be much better off. I know Mayor Stoddard from 6 Mile was here, and I saw him get up and leave. But the relationship that as a state delegation we have with our municipalities is excellent. We have not had one single meeting with our county council since we have since I've been in office, and that's the 2 years that Representative Collins and I have been in the state house. And also the fact that if we could have a school board that is willing to work with everyone else as well. I think that when you have folks that are on the same page, we can create jobs and by bringing in new business and new industry. And I don't have to, I'm not talking about just industry. I'm talking about local businesses where we encourage that, because if you want to cut taxes or you want taxes to remain low, the best way to do it is through economic development, because that's going to fund your schools, that's going to fund your county responsibilities, and that is the key to us being successful. So I would say the improvements I'd like to see in the next 2 years are the ability for all of our governmental officials to work together.
That's a big question. The first one that I would love to see more than anything else personally is, again, for us to be left alone. You know, be able to go do our own thing. Whether that's through education, whether that's through tax decreases, whether there's any number of things that could be done. And going back to the point you made, well, now South Carolina is getting a lot of jobs. We have an 8.something% corporate tax rate, and the only state in the union that is beating us is Texas. They have a 0 corporate tax rate. There's something there. I just want to put it out there. Now, as far as what can Pickens County do, I feel like that's really an unfair question because we're running for the state house. So I'll go ahead and give you the direct. I want for the state house to be done. One, I want a permanent list of concealed carry. I want gun rights to be protected and respected. And two, again, a lot of deregulation. I want to be able to teach my kid my home along with my neighbors' kids that want to and think my wife is a good job, who does a good job. I guess thank you for your time.
So there's obviously a lot of things we can do on a county level or on a state level, but for just local county, kind of to reiterate what's been said, and I agree with David. He said once you come to Pickens County, you don't want to leave. I obviously wanted to come back after I got out of the service, and I've got friends from work here that I kept telling them, you need to move to Pickens County, and once he moved, he loved it. So I don't think he's leaving. But, you know, the big part of building Pickens County is obviously, you know, how do we lower tax rates? How do we get business in? How do we lower property taxes? You know, how many of you would love to see no property taxes? Now, I don't know if that's possible, by the way. I have no idea how to get that done, but I would fight for it. They may yell at me all the time when I bring it up, but, you know, if we could get away from, hey, you know, these guys can take your property if you don't pay your taxes, or, you know, once you're deceased and your family, you know, forgets about it and they take it away, and, you know, now it's state-owned. And this goes right into, you know, I don't know how many of you go to these city council meetings, but I attend some of them, and a lot of times, it seems like every time I go, they talk about eminent domain. You know, how many times are we taking private citizens' property to put in, you know, like a kayak development. Now that sounds good, it's great for, you know, maybe it's good for the economy, but if we're taking someone's private property, that's not right. So there's ways, you know, we can make tremendous offers to buy that from them that you know, if they don't accept, hey, we find somewhere else. But there's things we can do in Pickens County locally, but a lot of it does roll back to that state level. How do we lower taxes? How do we get rid of things like property taxes? But obviously there's improvements to be made, and my time is up. Thank you.
I think the key thing is to make sure we have jobs in this county. Your community dries up if you don't have jobs. That's plain and simple. It's, you know, when you see young couples who have school-aged children moving out of communities because there's no jobs for them here, well, that's one of the reasons that the attendance at A.R. Lewis and Holly Springs went down because those young couples that were living up there that would have school-aged children, they were moving to Greenville and to Anderson and other places so they could find a job. So it sort of goes hand in hand. You know, if you don't have a job, then you got to go where the jobs are. So we've got to be able to bring jobs back into this county. And it's a fight. I mean, there's 46 other counties. There's 49 other states. It's a global market now. It's not just we're competing against Oconee County. We're competing against everybody for these jobs. And so you got to be able to put your best foot forward. You got to be able to put what you can do for them. As I said earlier, Pickens County's got an awful lot to offer, and we have so many things that we can offer to people. And so once we get the jobs back and the economy picks back up, and we have a vibrant economy, people start moving back in, things start happening again. Our schools start flourishing again, and then we're, you know, back to where we were when I was growing up, so to speak. When people like Tim Morgan was in high school running a football, you know, things like that. You know, things that we remember, things that were here, things that were good things. So that's the key to making Pickens County strong is making sure that we have jobs in this county.
Just offer a different answer, and then also from a state perspective, over the next 2 years, I hope that we see resolution and some sort of answer to our roads. Again, it's the number one issue in our county, number one issue in our state, and it will continue to be the number one until we address the issue. And unfortunately, in our first 2 years, we have improperly addressed it, and it is going to create a backlog for all of these other issues that we have talked about, whether it's education in Abbeville decision, whether it's the just exploding pension bomb that we have, whether it's any tax reform that we wish we could get. Nothing will occur until we address this roads issue. I believe that there is a solution out there. I believe there's enough of a coalition to have recurring funding in a conservative manner, and hopefully over the next 2 years we will see that.
On this one, would you or do you support a tax increase?
I'm a libertarian, so no. I mean, I feel like that's a pretty simple question, but you know, I do not support a tax increase. We're already being taxed enough as it is. We're already spending too much, and not gonna have a little extra time. Going back to the education thing, that much money being wasted, where is that money going to? Like, that money's being spent. It is. It's going somewhere. It's going to a lot of bureaucrats, to be frank. It's going to a lot of people who are doing nothing for our children. So why would we throw more money after bad? Before I would ever even consider a tax increase, I would at the very minimum say, let's stop wasting it first. I really don't think that's too much to ask. I mean, that's the moral thing to do. I mean, I was a scout. I mean, I'm an Eagle Scout. My first thing, I became a libertarian because I asked myself, okay, is it moral to support this? Is it moral to support this position or that position? And that's what I came to. It's a very simple question. And I feel like it's a fair question to ask. And I think we all should be asking that in our hearts of hearts. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, so likewise, the answer, the easy answer is no, I do not support tax increases. And yes, I do support increased audits or holding ourselves at Columbia and local accountable for how we spend our money. There's a lot of things, there's a lot of different taxes that I'd say I would get rid of first, or tax structures that we could do differently. A lot of times people ask about a flat tax, and will it or won't it work, or could it ever be voted on? The problem with flat tax, you know, a lot of people hear about the term being a regressive tax, you know, because it harms percentage-wise those who make less income. So there's things we could do tax-wise. I would love to, I would have said it earlier, eliminate property tax. I'd love to eliminate a lot of tax, really. But, you know, next time you get a paycheck or whatever type of pay stub you have, look at that tax rate. Look and see how much you're paying in taxes. And it's not just state taxes, it's not federal taxes, it's all the local taxes, state taxes, federal taxes combined. And you might be surprised at how much of your income, you know, if you're making $50,000, $60,000 a year and you're spending $25,000 on taxes because of everything that you purchased, there is something tremendously wrong. You know, our founding fathers, when the British, when the king decided to tax tea at 3%, we had a revolution. Now, I served in the Marine Corps. I'm not saying we should start a revolution. If we do, the Marines will take over. No, I'm sorry. But understand this, that we are taxed far beyond 3% and that we do nothing. We don't care. They raise taxes, and this isn't just state level. This is national. They raise taxes over and over, and we do nothing. It's time we start looking at who we're electing and who up here is saying absolutely no, and we need to get rid of other taxes. Thank you.
Well, the easy answer is to say no, but I'll not say no, because there comes a time that that's the absolute last resort that you have to have. And when everything else has been weighed and everything else has been looked at, and that's the only answer, that's the only way out. Sometimes you have to bite the bullet and do it. And unfortunately, that's not the popular answer to a lot of folks. But when you're an elected official and your job is to make sure that the citizenry of this state is taken care of, sometimes that's the absolute last resort that you can rely on. You know, Pickens County hasn't raised taxes in 11 years. The school board hadn't raised taxes in 10, 12 years. You know, look where we are. Look where we are. We're closing schools. We're losing jobs. I'm not saying to go out and raise taxes today. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying there comes a time sometimes that is the absolute last resort. And if you've ever been an elected official and you sign a no tax pledge, 99% of those people sign a no tax pledge will tell you, I wish I could get out of that pledge. Because sometimes it's the absolute only answer. And nobody likes that. I don't like taxes. Taxes go up, it affects me personally as well as business-wise. And I pay them just like everybody else does. But to simply stand up here and say, no, I will never raise taxes, I won't say that. Because that is sometimes that's the absolute and only answer you have to the situation at hand.
I think these two guys will confirm that I'm one of the most fiscally conservative reps in Columbia, and I would absolutely not say that I'm completely against taxes, tax increases, because in my opinion, that doesn't take facts into situation. As Chairman Hyatt states, you know, our county has taken that approach in our local government, and we have boxed ourselves into a corner to where Monday night the state delegation meets with the school board, and the first 20 minutes are them begging us to do a sales tax referendum. But in that same vein, we ask them, are you in support of a property tax? Are you in support of this sales tax that you're asking for? And at least two of the six said, well, no, we have no tax pledge. So facts have to present themselves. And the oddity, when you take it into, let's take with the gas tax. I voted against it, but that doesn't mean I'm against the gas tax, because I still want a good bill before I vote on it. But the oddity now is the way that we went ourselves. We're spending money from South Carolina people instead of a gas tax, which we've been told is one-third by out-of-state and tourists. So that money, that $400 million that we're going to spend on gas this year, a third of that could have come from out-of-staters. But because we have senators like Senator Davis that had stood up there, now we're taxing ourselves. And the other oddity to it was something like roads. The longer we delay, the more we're costing ourselves. In roads, we could repave at 10 to 20 times less than what it will be to reconstruct, which is what we're going to have to do. And it's evident on 385 when we tried to pave 385 last year. Now they're seeing when they dig down into it that they're going to have to completely reconstruct. So there's a time to be conservative, and then there's a time to be conservative and to understand the full broad issue and to know when you're really going to be conservative with the taxpayers.
You know, almost every day I receive some sort of a survey or a pledge in the mail from some organization wanting me to fill it out. All I do is send it back to them and tell them I don't fill out surveys, I don't do pledges, but I do have a voting record, and you can check that. You know, I agree with my colleagues in this delegation, Representative Hyatt and Collins, in that I'm not in favor of raising taxes as a general rule, but I'm never going to tell you that I won't raise taxes. Last year, I voted to raise the gas tax, and I would do it again. The reason that that bill did not was not successful is because the governor, for one thing, agreed with the gas tax, but she wanted a corresponding tax cut. And that tax cut over 10 years was going to be about $1.8 billion. When you take $1.8 billion out of a general budget, a fund budget of about 7.2 or 5, then that's a huge hole to replace. I will say this, we need comprehensive tax reform in South Carolina, and that's something that I fully intend to work on in the next 2 years if I'm fortunate enough to go back to Columbia.
Folks, we are running out of time, and we've got lots more questions. One question has come in two or three times, and may I ask our panelists if we could get a one-minute response to this? Do you support constitutional carry, and why?
Fitting that the Marine gets to answer whether we support constitutional carry first. Yes, I support constitutional carry. For those of you who may not know, and I know I got to speak fast, constitutional carry doesn't necessarily mean open carry. It means that you can carry without a permit. And a lot of individuals get very scared when I say carry without a permit because they say, oh, they don't have that 8-hour training class. Believe me, I've been trained thousands of hours in weapons, and that 8-hour class is by far the least effective that I've ever had. If you want training, I will happily teach you in Pickens County how to properly use and use a firearm. And I'm sure Tim Morgan would probably do the same thing. We can do a lot with constitutional carry, and I think it's wrong of individuals to vote against it when it's basically one of the most important amendments. You know, when you see number one and then number two, that was the founding father saying, "Hey, this is the second most important thing," and it guarantees that First Amendment. Freedom of speech. So yes, I support it. I'm not going to say that I'm open to open carry right away, but yeah, we can get constitutional carry.
By all means, I support constitutional carry. I don't have any problem with that at all. Actually, I voted for open carry this year. The bill had gotten sent over to the Senate, and I actually voted for that bill to pass the House, which it did. I do believe a person has a right to protect themselves. I certainly believe that. I also believe, to carry that a little bit further, now I don't know that big words in math, reciprocity, that means that we honor some other state's concealed weapons permit. I believe the state of South Carolina ought to honor every other state, and I think every other state ought to honor South Carolina. I believe if you're going through, I had an incident where a young man was going through Delaware, one of my constituents was going through Delaware. He had his weapon with him in the car like he always does, and he got pulled over in Delaware, spent 5 days in jail. And
They almost took his, almost took everything. They took his truck, confiscated his trailer, everything. And if some of our national delegation had got involved in it, he might have lost his job and everything that he had. I honestly believe that we ought to respect, we ought to receive every other state's concealed weapons permit just like they ought to receive ours.
Yeah, boys, this is going to be our libertarian streak here that we were talking about earlier.
I knew we'd take over that.
We did pass the permitless carry last year. We did pass reciprocity with Georgia, voting for both of those, and I believe both my colleagues did as well. And both of them are sitting in the Senate, along with a number of other things. But I am to the degree on this that I'm a big believer in personal responsibility. I think we have criminal laws, and if anything does happen, we can handle them through the criminal statutes. So to answer your question, yes.
While I voted in favor of the bill that we talked about, everyone doesn't have the training that a Marine has. And as a former circuit judge in South Carolina, I have seen what can happen when guns fall into the hands of people who are not trained and who are poorly trained. So I do think that even though I believe in the right to bear arms and fully support the Second Amendment, an 8-hour course is the very least that we can ask for in this regard. You know, the Second Amendment that we talk about, and we talk about limiting other amendments, if we went back to the way that the Second Amendment was written, we'd be walking around with muskets and handguns, and we wouldn't have the automatic weapons that we have now. So I think that we have a number of issues that we have to deal with, but I do believe that we should have some training involved in possessing a weapon.
Mentioned this earlier, didn't I? Yes, I support permitless concealed carry, constitution carry. Like David, I actually support open carry as well. We have a right to defend ourselves. And the states that support open carry, New Hampshire as a perfect example, are some of the safest in the entire union. I mean, you can't argue with the numbers. You can't argue with the results. Now, it is concerning that you have need more training. But again, you have to have a certain license to be a licensed trainer. I mean, I'm sure Joe would love to teach you, but he better get a license first. I mean, that's something. Yes, open carry all the way. I completely agree with David on this one. Thank you.
We have a number of additional questions that we have not been able to get to tonight related to the lottery system, school choice, Confederate memorials, and so on. So may I ask if the candidates are available to stay for a little bit after we finish up, then you are invited to come and speak with them about your particular issues that we haven't been able to address tonight. It is time now for our closing statements, and since we started at that end to begin with, I think we'll start at this end with Mr. McCurry, and each one of the candidates will be invited to offer a 2-minute closing.
Thank you, ma'am. And again, thank you for all you guys for coming out here. It is very encouraging to see this many people being active and coming out there and supporting each one of us. Not just me and Joey. I'm not the best spoken person. I am not the most educated on this stage, but I've self-studied, I'm self-taught, and I'm very passionate about these issues. I have reasons why I believe each one of my points, and to be frank, I'll listen to every single one of you. I'm more than happy to keep my mind open with you. Come up and give me a logical reason to reconsider my opinions. I have, for a long time, studied these opinions. I When I joined the National Guard, I asked myself when I took the oath what this oath meant, what liberty was, and why we're defending it. Why is it worth defending? And this is where I wound up. Now, I went from Signal and IT guy to try and make a difference in my local community because I feel like not enough is being done to protect liberty. That's why I'm doing what I'm doing. I mean, that's why Joey's up here. That's why I'm sure why we're all up here. Asking for your vote, asking for your time, asking for your trust. But I'm asking for your trust not just because of the fact that I am, you know, a liberty lover or because I'm a libertarian. I'm asking for your vote because I stand up for what I believe and I have conviction in what I believe. I would say no to taxes. Because before considering taxes, let's get rid of the waste first. And there's a lot of it. I mean, they stand up there and say, they go up there and waste your money and say, well, we need more. You can't cut that out. You can't cut that out. No. Stand firm, stand solid, and say no. Thank you.
Yeah, so there's a couple points I want to make, and then we'll kind of close up here. But, you know, yes, when we start talking about taxes, and it's hard to say no directly. You know, as incomes increase because of what we just talked about, of increasing better industry, better revenues from those industry, more and more people in here, that raises revenues without having to have a tax increase. We can bring in more taxes without having a tax increase. We can also moderate and do some audits and do more and more, holding those responsible for how and where we spend our money. As far as reciprocity, obviously, as a concealed carry holder, I obviously believe that I would love to carry in all states. Maybe not all the way out to California, but as far as possible. But one question to think about, and this is a libertarian mindset, why do we need a license to carry a firearm in South Carolina? Take that a step further. Why do we need a license to carry a firearm, something protected by the Second Amendment, in the U.S.? I'd love for someone to tell me that. That goes one step farther. I'm sorry, I'm going to get off traffic, but I've got to answer something. I shouldn't be held accountable for what a criminal's going to do with a weapon. So because of that 8 hours training, because someone commits a crime because there's a felon that has done something wrong with a weapon, well, that requires all of us to take 8 hours of training. We talked about penal code. We have a great penal code for crime. Let's punish them. Let's get them in jail. Let's arrest them and charge them. That's great. That's what it's for. But an 8 hour class doesn't do anything to stop a criminal. A criminal is a criminal. Once he does that crime, once he's a felon, you know, great. If they're committing crime with it, an 8 hour class for you and me does nothing. You know, in general, a libertarian mindset says, you know, we're free to make our own choices. We're free to believe in the U.S. Look, I don't have all the answers. We have a lot of work to do in our government. It's scary to think that the people may be responsible. It's scary to say, hey, we don't have a bailout. We don't have a government bailout for this large corporation. We don't have a government bailout for Pickens County Schools. It's scary to think that this county won't be bailed out if we don't have, you know, this tax or this or all these institutions in place. But guess what? You have to pull that Band-Aid off. We can't continue this road forever. Everyone in this room sees that. You see this on a national level. When are we going to say enough is enough? We must change course. Eventually, that's going to happen. So I think, and I got to close up here, but I would love to stay after. I'll talk to anybody that's available. And happy Mother's Day. I know it's late. My wife's outside, but I have a great wife and a wonderful mom.
Thank you very much, and thank you to the League of Women Voters again for arranging this and for all the hard work that you folks do day in and day out. Thank you to each and every one of you that have taken your time to be here tonight. This is what the process is all about. This seat does not belong to me. This seat belongs to the people of House District 4, and I've had the privilege of sitting in this seat for the last 12 years, and I'm seeking another term, and I certainly appreciate your vote, you folks that live in that district. But let's just... I travel this state quite a bit, and I have an opportunity to do a lot of things as an elected official. But I can tell you, there's no place like Pickens County. I wouldn't want to be anywhere else. I wouldn't want to raise my children anywhere else. I wouldn't want to live anywhere else except Pickens County. This is the greatest place to be, and it's because of folks like yourself that are taking your time to get involved in the process,
You could be doing anything else you wanted. There's a lot of other things you could be doing tonight, but you chose to be here tonight to listen to us. And I want to thank the other gentleman sitting up here in the stage. I've always said that if you offer yourself a public service, you're halfway crazy anyway. Because and then when you get elected, you find out you're really crazy. So, but thank you, you guys, for offering yourselves and giving of your time. But let's continue to make Pickens County strong. I know there's other people offering their sales for service that are here tonight. Ask them questions. They're here to talk to you as well. They're offering themselves for other positions other than what we're doing. But we're all in this thing together. You know, we're all in this thing together. That's what Pickens County is. We're a community. And as long as we stay that way, we can accomplish anything. If we wanted to live in New York or California or all those places, we would move there. But we like it here. We love it here. We want to raise our families here. And that's why I offered myself for service 12 years ago, because I wanted to make a difference. I want to make a difference for my children. My wife, you know, I talked about it for quite some time, and my wife finally said, either do something about it or shut up. And so I offered myself for public service, and I was fortunate enough to win. But if I don't win again in November, there's other things that I can do to make this community strong. And so there's all types of things. And I thank you for being here. Thank you for taking your time. Thank you for getting involved in the process. Continue to encourage people to get out and vote. Continue to get them registered. And let's continue to make Pickens County what it is.
To the League of Women Voters, thank you for organizing. We've organized a couple in the past. I know how difficult it can be. You all had a great turnout. Thank you all. I say this at every public event that we have. You can be anywhere in the world right now, and it's a beautiful Monday. Easley, last I saw, top of the sixth, and we were down 2-1. Y'all could be at the Easley baseball game right now, but you're here participating, and I just appreciate it. It is a truly humbling experience, and it's an honor serving my hometown. Each night I go to bed, and I know that there's 38,000 people there that rely on us in some form or fashion. And that's a responsibility that I don't take lightly. The way that I view public service is sort of like a track experience. And all we're doing is carrying the baton. As Chairman Hyatt said, this is certainly not my seat. This is the good people of District 5. Chairman Owens, he ran the event for a while and handed it off to me. And all I'm trying to do is run as hard as I can and hand it off to the next person. Hopefully we'll continue to improve our great state. Hopefully that'll filter down to Pickens County and for me specifically easily. But what you can get over the next at least 2 years if I'm reelected is someone that will work his tail off for you, that will be as transparent as possible. And that gets me in trouble a lot, but I try to be as transparent as possible, and someone that's going to focus on the real issues at hand, and that's not always the case, at least in Columbia. But again, thank you, and look forward to talking to anybody that needs to.
To our moderator in the League of Women Voters, our timekeeper, our mic transfer person, thank you very much. Thank all of you for being here tonight. The last 2 years, it's been an honor and a privilege to represent House District 3 in Columbia. You know, I chose to live here in Pickens County. I came to college at Clemson a number of years ago, and when I came here, I made up my mind that I wanted to come back. And I spent my adult life trying to get back here and made it about almost 10 years ago now. You know, when I talk about serving, and this is truly public service, I try to be responsive to my constituents. And I look around this room and I see a number of them that I receive emails from or I receive communications from, and I always try to answer those. You know, if you're not in my district, you might not get an answer because you are represented by someone else. But I believe that we need to be responsive to our constituents, and this is part of it. Over the next 2 years, if I'm fortunate enough to be elected, I want to be part of solving our infrastructure problems once and for all. I want to be part of comprehensive tax reform. I also want to continue work on dyslexia, which I started this year and want to continue, because one in five students here in Pickens County and throughout the state, throughout this country, are affected by this reading disorder. So certainly want to continue that. I want to continue a reasonable, sensible approach to government. That's what I promised 2 years ago, and I ask you to hold me to that because I believe that I have fulfilled that pledge to you. It's an honor and a privilege to be here with these five gentlemen. It's truly an honor and a privilege to serve with the two men beside me. And I ask for your support if you live in House District 3, because I believe that what is good for House District 3 is good for South Carolina. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.